Hello friends, welcome to video series on geography. My name is Manjunath and this is my blog where you can find text files of all the videos. In my previous video, I've explained about continental drift theory. In this video, I'll be explaining about seafloor spreading. So previously, we have started with geomorphology in which the first topic was Earth's interior and then we studied Earth movements. So please go and watch these videos so that your basics will be clear. And then now we have started tectonics. In tectonics, we have finished continental drift theory and now we are going to see seafloor spreading, and the next topic will be plate tectonics. The first important concept under seafloor spreading is continental convectional current theory. This theory was explained by Arthur Holmes in 1930s. This theory mainly came into existence after observing the ocean relief. So we'll see how ocean relief made a difference to the understanding of movement of Earth's lithospheric plates. And then one more important thing is seismic activity along plate margins. So based on all these proofs, that is ocean relief and seismic activity, there came a concept called as seafloor spreading, which was explained by Harry S. And based on the convectional current theory and concept of seafloor spreading, the continental drift theory was completely discarded because of various shortcomings. So first let us understand how ocean relief and seismic activity have influenced the evolution of seafloor spreading. So initially the ocean surface was thought to be a plain land without much relief, but during world wars and due to improvement in navigation, scientists discovered various features like coyotes, seamounts, and then most importantly ridges and then trenches and various other relief features of oceans. So this put a question mark on scientists on how these things came into existence, and in an attempt to explain these kind of relief features, they gave rise to different theories, and one such important theory is convectional current theory, which is followed by seafloor spreading theory. So what is seismic activity? Seismic activity is nothing but the production of earthquake waves or seismic waves at plate margins. These mainly happened between two oceanic plates, that is between ridges, and then between oceanic plate and continental plate called trenches. Usually earthquake waves at the ridges are called shallow focus earthquake waves, which are of low intensity, whereas at trenches, the earthquakes are deep focus earthquakes, which are of great intensity. So we'll study these shallow focus and deep focus earthquakes in concept of earthquakes. So if you move towards convectional current theory, so first, these are the evidences, that is seismic activity and ocean relief, and especially the nature of rocks surrounding the ridge. So we'll see how these things prove seafloor spreading. First, let us understand convectional current theory. Convectional current theory explains the movement of oceanic plates as well as continental plates. But from the perspective of seafloor spreading, we'll only look at the movement of oceanic plates, that is plates within the oceans and their movement. So convection current theory, as explained by Arthur Holmes, goes this way. Usually, Earth is made up of different concentric layers with varying physical and chemical properties. We know that outer layer is called crust, and below that it is mantle, and then we have outer core and then inner core. Crust is about 30 to 100 kilometers in thickness, whereas mantle's thickness varies from about 400 kilometers to about 2900 kilometers. And then from there till about 6300 kilometers, we have core. So according to continental convectional current theory, there is continuous movement of magma within the mantle, and these movement of magma are called as convectional currents. There is also movement of magma in outer core, which is in molten state. This movement of magma is also significant, but for our understanding of seafloor spreading, it is not of import significant any significant in understanding of seafloor spreading. But the convectional currents in outer core, just like as we see in mantle, are very important in study of magnetic field, because the magnetic field of Earth is mainly generated due to convectional currents in outer core. So let us now see about the convectional currents in only mantle. We know that Earth's interior is at very high temperatures compared to the surface. Usually the core is at a temperature of about 6000 or 7000 degrees Celsius, whereas the outer core is about 3000 to 4000 degrees Celsius. And coming to mantle, its temperature varies. At the crust, it is only about few hundred degrees Celsius, but at the outer core, it reaches about 2,000 to 3,000 degrees Celsius. So this temperature difference is very important in generating convection currents. So previously, I've explained what a convectional current is. Simple example would be a boiling pot of water. So when we boil a pot of water, what happens is the water at the surface, at the bottom layers, gets very hot due to heating effect, and this hot water is comparatively less denser due to accumulation of heat and separation between molecules. So this water rises to the top, and the top layers, which are comparatively cooler, they are more denser, and as a result, they sink to the bottom. And this cycle repeats as long as there is supply of heat or there is difference in heat between various layers. Similarly, there is heat difference between outer core and the crust between which there is mantle. So mantle has a medium which is semi-molten state or plastic state. That is, it is comparatively free to move compared to solid rocks. So this temperature difference has created convectional currents, as we have seen in this example. So these convection currents usually have different directional flow. For example, when two convectional currents meet, that is, the part of the convectional current which is vertical in direction are called as rising limbs when they are rising upwards, and when they are falling towards the inner core, they are called as falling limbs. So mainly it is due to differences in temperature, and then we have seen this is rising limbs, and the other one which falls towards the core is falling limbs. So when two rising limbs meet, usually there is additional amount of matter which accumulates below the Earth's crust, and this accumulated matter with the involvement of rising limbs creates huge amount of pressure, which results in a stress created in the lithospheric plate. As a result, the lithospheric plates moves away from each other because of the stress created, and there can be a weak spot which is created between these lithospheric plates. And in the other case, where there are falling limbs, usually there is movement of matter which is going downwards or towards the Earth's core. As a result, there is some sort of negative pressure which is created in this region. Hence, the plate is pulled towards the falling limbs. As a result, trenching occurs. This is called trench. So we have seen near the rising limbs, usually the ridges occur, whereas trenches occur near falling limbs. So what happens is the denser plate subducts below a less denser plate. So this is the less denser plate, sorry, high, greater plate with greater density, whereas this plate is plate with lesser density. So the plate with higher density subducts or plunges below the lower denser plate. So this is what convection current theory is all about. So it explains the movement of lithospheric plates away or towards from each other. So how is concept of sea floor spreading different from convectional current theory? In convectional current theory, we see only the movement of lithospheric plates. Sea floor spreading is the exact explanation of convectional current theory with few additions. In sea floor spreading, we also talk about the movement of rocks or volcanic magma on surface of the sea floor, and the way the sea floor spreads with continuous emissions of magma. So we have seen rising limbs give rise to stress. As a result, there is a weak zone created here, and there is volcanic vent which is created. And through this volcanic vent, there is huge amount of volcanic outpourings. And this volcanic outpourings is important in our study of seafloor spreading. So there are two types of proofs which are important in understanding seafloor spreading. One is nature of rocks, and there are one more concept called paleomagnetism. We'll see all these in detail later. But for now, we should understand a little about the nature of magma. We usually have two kinds of volcanic landforms. One is called as conical volcanic mountains, whereas other ones are called as fissure type volcanoes, where the landform created by volcano is completely flat. So this is the example for Deccan Traps, whereas this one is for best example for conical type volcanoes is Mount Fujiyama in Japan. So what is the difference between these two volcanic types? In conical type, the kind of magma which is thrown out is called andesitic magma or acidic magma. Its silica content is too high, that is, it has greater proportion of silica, and when there is greater proportion of silica in magma, then the magma is highly viscous, that is, it is very thick, hence it doesn't flow through long distances. As a result, as and when there is outpouring of magma along this vent, the magma comes out and solidifies quickly around the vent, as a result building up this conical mountain. Hence, this mountain gets thicker and thicker in size and grows in height because of continuous volcanic eruptions. So, coming to fissure type volcano. So, let us see. In a fissure type volcano, usually there is volcanic eruption happening somewhere along the fissure or a crack. And this volcanic eruption, the magma is less acidic or it is basic in nature because of less amount of silica. So, in this, the silica content is completely very little compared to other proportion of matter. So, due to less content of silica, this magma is called as basic in nature. And one important property is it is less viscous and it can flow to a longer distances without getting solidified. So, when there is volcanic eruption happening along a fissure volcano, then this magma flows out and flows through very long distances on either side depending on slope. So, the important concept here is the spreading of magma when it is basic or basic in nature. So how is it important for our seafloor spreading concept? The magma that flows out of this lithospheric ridges or the ridges that are present in under the sea, which are called as submarine ridges, is basic in nature and it can flow through longer distances. As a result, when there is volcanic eruptions happening along the ridge, this volcano flows for a very long distance and this gets accumulated in various layers as well as varying on different time periods in which volcanic eruptions have occurred. There are different layers both which happens perpendicular to the ridge as well as parallel to the ridge. We can see these are parallel layers. So, if you see, so these we will see as proofs of seafloor spreading in the next layer slide. So, let us move to evidences of seafloor spreading theory. So, seafloor spreading theory is nothing but extension of continental convectional current theory with few additions of the nature of rocks and then paleomagnetism and related concepts like seismic activity. So, let us see first what is paleomagnetism, then we will study what is nature of rocks and how all these are evidences of seafloor spreading. Paleomagnetism is a concept which basically depends on Earth's magnetic field. First, let us see what is Earth's magnetic field. We know that due to movement of magma near the core, there is magnetic field which is created. And this magnetic field has a polarity where the north first, okay, there is a magnetic bar. First, let us assume a simple magnetic bar. Then it has a north pole and then it has a south pole. Usually magnetic field lines originate on the north pole and end up absorbed by the south pole. So this is how magnetic field lines exist around a magnet. Similar way, even Earth's magnetic field is directed in such way. But Earth, we can consider it as a bigger magnet. So we can see usually field lines occur at north pole and then sink into the south pole. So this is the basic nature of magnetic field lines. So even Earth has a magnetic field and the rocks within the Earth, which are ferrous in nature or which have magnetic properties, are influenced by this magnetic field of Earth. And one more important concept is that this magnetic field doesn't have the same kind of polarity throughout the lifetime of Earth, and usually polarity changes. So normally today, that is what we see in present days, the magnetic north pole is towards the south pole of Earth and whereas magnetic south pole is towards the north pole of Earth. So we have a reverse magnetic field presently, but this is as it is normal or the present day's magnetic field, we considered it as a normal magnetic field. Whereas in reversed case, the north pole and the north pole shift towards north pole of the magnetic field shift towards the north pole and south pole of the magnetic field shift towards the south pole. So this reversal takes place about few million years from time to time. So the time period between this successive reversal is about few million years. So with this reversal in magnetic field, usually there is huge influence on rocks which are magnetic in nature. So let us consider rock which has magnetic properties. So what happens is when there is a magnetic field, usually then this rock aligns in such a way that its north pole receives the field lines from the south pole of the Earth, magnetic south of Earth, and its south pole receives magnetic field lines from the other pole of the Earth. So let us look at this. So this is the bar. Usually we can see that these field lines are originating in the north, and these field lines are absorbed at the south. So in a simple magnetic bar, there is a concept where like poles repel and opposite poles attract each other. For example, if there are two knots, magnets with two knots placed in the very near proximity, then these two magnets will repel each other. Whereas if a north pole and south pole are placed near each other, then they attract. And coming to magnetic field lines, usually magnetic field lines flow from north to south. So what we observe is these field lines coming from the Earth's magnetic field, which are coming from north, are usually observed by south pole of the Earth's rock, magnetic rock, and then these field lines come out from the north pole of the magnetic rock and end up at south of the Earth's magnetic field. So this is how it looks. So it will be from north to south, and then from south to from north to south. So this is the basic way in which rocks are aligned. So if this thing is reversed, like we can see in the other picture, then usually we have opposite thing happening, the north to south and then north to south. So we can see with the reversal of magnetic field, the magnetic alignment in rocks also changes. So this is the base of paleomagnetism. We can see this is the line along which seafloor spreading is happening. And when there is outpouring of magma, usually the rocks with ferrous or magnetic in nature solidifies due to the solidification of magma, and they are formed. And when they form at a distance, usually they are under the influence of certain type of magnetic field. It can be normal or reversed magnetic field. Based on that, a certain alignment of rocks is seen. Usually let us assume that this is the alignment of rocks at a certain period, and after some times there is reversal in magnetic field. Then when there is a rock layer which is forming before that, then this rock layer will have a different alignment of rocks. That is, the alignment is influenced by reversal in magnetic field. So this is what paleomagnetism is all about. So these kind of rocks which have similar magnetic alignments are usually found about equidistant from the Earth's ridge. That is, if a layer here has this kind of orientation of rocks, then even a layer equidistant from the ridge will have the same kind of orientation on the other side. And if this layer has this orientation, and a layer which is equidistant from the center will have the same kind of orientation. So paleomagnetism explains the change in orientation of rocks based on reversal of magnetic fields. So this is a very important concept, which is a very important evidence for both seafloor spreading theory as well as plate tectonics. So this gives example about this. So clearly explains how seafloor spreading is taken into consideration. So by these examples and equidistant rocks, one comes to a conclusion that the seafloor is spreading or extending outwards. So there is one more important concept called nature of rocks. So in nature of rocks, we'll see rocks of same physical and chemical properties occurring equidistant from the volcanic vent. For example, this layer has a counterpart on the other side. This layer is the counterpart for this one, other one. So they are at a equidistance from the vent, and they have the same kind of nature. That is, their magnetic properties are same, as well as their chemical nature, the kind of brittle or hardness they have achieved due to solidification is same, and various other physical properties are similar. So this thing is true for all other layers. They have equal opposite counterparts on the other side. And also the rocks occurring at the very close to the vent are much younger than the rocks which are at a greater distance. Usually rocks at greater distance, they are old ones. So these rocks are all old ones, whereas the rocks which are forming at the very close proximity of the vent are younger ones. And also usually one assumes that oceans being constantly underwater, they might have formed very much earlier than building of continents. As a result, the rocks should be much older. But in reality, what scientists have observed that the rocks of the ocean floor are much younger compared to the rocks on the continents. So why are these rocks young? These rocks are comparatively young because of constant outpouring of magma and this magma being spreading keeps on spreading across large distance, and hence it solidifies at a greater distance, and there is solidification of rocks at a particular distance, and these rocks are much younger because they are formed from recently from solidification of this magma coming out of the vent. So comparatively, if you compare the continental rocks, they are settled there for millions of years and they are comparatively older. So continental rocks are older, whereas the oceanic rocks are younger. So even this thing explains that there is continuous volcanic activity in the ocean floor compared to Earth's continents. So all these proofs finally explained seafloor spreading. So seafloor spreading, we have seen, it is mainly based on convectional current theory. And seafloor spreading's evidences mainly are paleomagnetism and then nature of rocks. We have seen how younger rocks and older rocks are separated by greater distances, mainly due to outpouring of magma. So what is spreading? Spreading is simply the outpouring of magma which spreads to a longer distance. So spreading is mainly because of two, three different factors. One is the movement of lithospheric plates. Here we see, along with volcanic activity, there is movement of lithospheric plates in opposite directions due to stress caused in this region. As a result, the plates are moving away from each other, and this movement also results in spreading of seafloor or extension of this seafloor. And then there is one more important thing in the form of volcanic activity, where magma moves for a very large distance and keeps on accumulating as layers. Even this has contributed to the spreading of seafloor. So there are mainly, seafloor spreading is mainly due to two reasons. One is the movement of lithospheric plates, and the other one is mainly due to of solidification magma at different distances. And also, when there is magma outpouring at this point, usually there is a lot of stress created in this region. As a result, the rocks are pushed in opposite directions. And even due to this reason, the rocks spread along the seafloor, which contributes to seafloor spreading. So this is all about seafloor spreading. And one more important concept is the existence of seismic activity along the ridges. So we have very important seismic activity along the continents as well, margins of continents and oceans, but now we don't study that. We'll see that in plate tectonics. For us, in seafloor spreading, the importance are ridges. So this is a ridge line. Usually there is huge amount of volcanism as well as seismic activity happening along this ridges. Seismic activity means earthquake waves. So we have seen that earthquake waves along the ridges are shallow focus earthquakes, which can be detected by seismographs. So if we construct a pattern of seismographic observations, we see that earthquake or seismic waves are very intense along this ridge compared to the other regions of the oceans. So this also proves that these regions are constantly in activity. The activity is very frequent and constant. It is happening for billions of years and it keeps on happening every day. So from this, we observe that seafloor spreading is a continuous process and it has been happening for millions of years and it is continuing even now. So this is the end of seafloor spreading. If you like my video, please subscribe and like my channel. I'll be posting more videos on geography, and thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel. Thank you.